Okay, so I'm still trying to recover from this language of the last lunch. The last time there was a last meal in Jerusalem, something very dramatic happened. And aside from that...
It was the Last Supper.
Yeah, yeah.
We're celebrating.
And aside from that, it raises the kind of inconceivable possibility that these 5 days are actually coming to an end. And so...
Just to point out, yeah. After the Last Supper, something happened, and then there was another meal.
That's true, yeah. Okay. So maybe we'll take that as the ideal model. We have just over an hour and a half to try to say something by way of conclusion. Of course, I'm certain that this conversation that we've had here over the last 5 days will go on in various forms, and we're going to talk about that. I thought that we should try to concentrate our remarks on two questions. These are what Yael has been calling the WH questions. That is to say, why Dandin? Let us see after 5 days of intense discussions if we can address again now something about the peculiar power and appeal of this particular work. Why Dandin? But we're also going to talk about whither Dandin, because this project will be going on, and there's the notion of a volume that we hope will eventually come out, and we need to talk about this, at least in some preliminary way. So I'm going to say just a word or two about why Dandin. Actually, I have a rather long list of things that might fit into that category that I've learned in the course of the last 2 days. But I'm not going to impose that list upon you. But I'll say one or two things by way of starting the discussion, perhaps. When all is said and done, we've been talking about the movement and transmission and transformation of these materials as they go from culture to culture. And there's been some very interesting and powerful images of that process, including that mirror image that I mentioned just half an hour ago. But we have to bear in mind that there's some particular, maybe mysterious or secret power about this book. And the book belongs to a person who wrote it. There was a Dandin who actually wrote a coherent work. And there is, I think, something that we need to say, maybe a lot that still needs to be said about that book in relation to the wider problems of how this book appears in various other places. So, I mean, people have said many things about it, and I'm not going to try to reiterate any of that, but I just want to say there's one possible way that we could ask ourselves how we might better penetrate the, let's call it the kind of underlying logic or the deep dynamic of this work. How the Kavya Dausha works in that why Dandin mode. Because after all, whether it was the Kavya Dausha itself or materials related to it, preceding it, coming after it, however we want to understand it, there's no question that we've seen these footprints everywhere, from Kanchipuram to China. So one way to think about it, I'll say this and I'll open the floor, one way to think about it, I think, is to ask ourselves about whether there are underlying principles that are perhaps not the explicitly articulated principles of the analytical model or mode that Dandin has offered us, or perhaps they're half articulated, but they're kind of waiting for a formulation that might come from people like us. In other words, people who are reading this book and noting things that are not stated as the obvious explicit principles of analysis. I want to give you just one of these, even though, as I said, I have a rather long list. But there, or maybe I'll say two things. One thing, there's something that Yigal said on the very first day, the very opening of this conference. Yigal talked about a notion of distinctiveness through indistinguishability. Sorry, I can't even say it. Indistinguishability. Distinctiveness through perception that two things are, as it were, indistinguishable. So, you know, Dundin actually never said that in those terms. He says things that are kind of close to that at times, and there's a principle, the kind of overriding or underwriting principle. He says things that appear in the distinctive formulations of different figures. You know. But that principle, which seems to me a very powerful one, and it's built around a notion of singularity, which I myself tend to think is perhaps one of the fundamental vectors of the entire work, notion of how a particular poetic statement is going to be singular, even though it may well be patterned along ways that can be formulated, and he does formulate them. Although, again, I want to say I don't think that this is a book about categorization, about lists of figures. It's certainly, you know, something that goes far, far beyond that. If we think of it in terms of lists and categories, we're certainly going to miss the real secret and the power of it. So here's an underlying principle like that. I believe we would be able to formulate together, perhaps, maybe something like 5 to 10 such meta principles that belong to the true expressive power of this model, you know, that have not been properly formulated. So there's one. If I were to do another one, the next thing I would maybe think about is something that Gary said. Very interesting statement in the presentation on Yamaka. Gary formulated a notion of a tension, you might say, between the aesthetic effort, and that also, I guess, means the aesthetic effect, which is derailed by the effort necessary to decode it. That makes sense in the context of Yamaka. So if you think of it, I mean, here's a very productive tension that may actually go well beyond simply the Shabdalankara mode. Actually, it also applies to many Artalankaras. So let's imagine that there's some kind of interesting balance between these two vectors, you know? Okay. So, I mean, that's just by way of example. And, you know, and we'll see what happens, but I'd be happy to supply other such ideas. I think we should be looking for those kinds of principles. So here, I'm throwing this open, and I want to know what you think today, after 5 days, as to why Dundin? Why this book, or this complex of ideas, or this analytical mode was so generative and powerful? And what we have learned about this in the course of listening to these absolutely brilliant and ravishing lectures. Why Dundin? That's the point of it. David?
I was just thinking, that famous thing in Bamaha, where he talks about that the work needs a commentary, that it'll be a feast for those who can do it, but for everybody else it'll be a total wash. And it seems like maybe Dundin doesn't hold that kind of point of view. You know, in some ways that work is a little bit different in the sense that it's inviting. It's inviting commentary, and this is what has been as a theme that's been coming out in our conversations. That there's something about that invitation for that, and that there isn't a sense of loss if it's necessary to even analyze his own, or you know, open up his own work and diminish it in some ways. It's like kind of it's okay if you diminish Dundin, you know. I'm not worried about that.
Ahamekam vaktum icchami. Bhamaha kavin na protsahayati. Vyadhaye dandanaya va akavitvam na doshaya, but kukavitvam punasakshan mutimahur manishi. Kinto dandi navin kavin protsahayati. Navidyate yadyapi purvavasana gunanubandhi pratibhanam adbhutam. Gunena yatnena cha vagupasita dhruvam karotyeva kamapyanugraham. Mama prachina janma samprapta pratibha nasti tathapi yadi aham yatnam karomi yadi aham prayatnam karomi kavihi bhavami iti asha utpadayati atayeva prathama samskrita kavayitri mahakavayitri ganga devi madhura vijaye ekam vakyam vakti acharya dandino vacham achanta amrita sampadam vikaso vedhasa patnyaha vilasa mani darpanaha iti vilasa mani darpanaha iti vadati prayashaha kavyadarsham manasi kritva तथा वदति आदर्शः दर्पणः इति अतः यः कविः बुभूषति कविः भवितुम् इच्छति तस्य दण्डिनः प्रबन्धे विपुला सामग्री वर्तते कथं कवयितुं शक्यते प्रपञ्चं दृष्टुं प्रपञ्चं वर्णयितुं के मार्गाः सन्ति इति दर्शयितुं दंडी प्रभवति अतः कारणात् अहम् दंडिनम् साक्षात् ब्रह्म समानम् परिगणयामि अतः संस्कृत भाषायां कदाचित् कवित्वमासीत् सर्वं समाप्तम् इति विचारः मह्यं न रोचते तत्र पुनः वक्तव्यमस्ति अस्यां भाषायां तादृशी शक्तिरस्ति इति मम भावना अतः कारणात् तादृश संस्कृत साहित्य विकासाय दण्डिनः वचांसि नूनं प्रोत्साहकानि भवन्ति अतः दण्डी अद्यापि अपेक्षितः इति मम भावना
सो आई एम फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल यू शुड नो दैट Everybody here can see that there's some things that can only be said in Sanskrit. And it's not by chance that we heard this now in Sanskrit, but just in case there's some people who don't understand what was said, I just want to summarize in a few words, some of these in some other debased language, some of what, some upper branch language, so what Rajarao Garo said. So he said that in distinction from Bhamaha, who tells us that it's not a disaster to if you don't write poetry. You know, if you're going to write poetry, you better write good poetry. But it's not a disaster not to write poetry. So in a way, he kind of fails to encourage the production of poetry. In contrast to that, Dandin indeed encourages poets to write. Even poets who may not have great genius, but have access to the rich heritage of the past and have learned the modes and patterns, the grammar, one might say, of the past. Dandin allows that, makes it possible for even such a person who feels a need to become a poet, a bhupushaya, he'd like to be a poet, makes it possible for that to happen. And within that context, a very beautiful verse of Ganga Devi from the Madhura Vijayam. Mm. And the upshot of all of this is that a poet who is capable of internalizing these mechanisms and really writing poetry, he's like God himself. And should be like God himself. Did I do justice? I'm afraid I didn't do justice, but that's sort of the gist.
It's interesting that in this light, I mean, this is what even the, of course, the translator, someone like Ashrivijaya in Kaviraja Marga, it's, I mean, he's actually even taking it further that, you know, he's trying to actually begin a whole thing that you can write in Kannada also, and you can become masters in that language. And I think this is one of the reasons why he puts the production of the writing of a Mahakavya at the end of that work, because it's almost like the final climax of it all is to write literature now. You can actually produce Mahakavya in Kannada, and it's at the end that he puts it. So maybe this impulse is actually drawn out in very clear.
The important point is an enabling quality about the Kavya Darshan.
Well, I think that what Nagaraja Rao had to say about that fits with what Igal said at the very beginning about Dandin's openness, because fundamentally it's an openness to the power and the potential of language. I mean, he makes that clear at the beginning, that he has a reverence for the power of language. But it's not a shrinking reverence. It's a confident, a sort of confidence that that poetry will be possible. And I think that's why the name of mirror at whatever point it may have come in, is a good name, because he is holding up, you know, a mirror to the potential, the poetic potentials of language. And I think that's why, you know, some of us have felt that there is more going on in the examples than in the expository statements that he makes, because the examples place on view a wider range of possibilities than he actually describes.
Just a comment, just to kind of give an explicit example of that generative power invitation for young students. In that text, the Udayadithya Alankaram, it says explicitly that this text is for this Sri Bharita Balaka, those youngsters. It's only natural that Dandin will serve as the model, or in the 12th century, already a long time after Dandin came out and so many others. But it is Dandin that can do that for youngsters, for the beginners, in an inviting way.
Although one of the mysteries remains his name, if he's so inviting.
Discipline.
From a youngster's point of view, it's a little worrisome.
Following on from what Gary just said, I think that there's also a slightly coercive aspect to the Kavya Dasha, the beginning of the Kavya Dasha, especially. I mean, we can take it as a jocular pun, the idea that if you do not speak correctly, you are a beast. But that's not taken as a pun by later commentators. It's certainly taken very seriously by the Sri Lankan reception. And so it's, while there is the godlike goal of being praised as a god for knowing the Shastras, in Ratnashri the counterposition is that if you do not know the Shastras, in Dandan it explicitly says you're a blind man, right? So these are all people on the periphery, these are outsiders to the Brahmanical society.
And the whole world is not blind.
Oh, right. So that, maybe there's that other aspect there. Sorry to dampen the mood.
It speaks to this whole nexus and the connection with the Mahabhashya, which the three of you are much better to speak to than I am, so I'm going to invite you to. And about the so please, just you.
Why is
from the Paspasha.
Yeah, the Paspashamics. Yeah. But Paspashamics is not so much about writing poetry.
At all.
It has a whole series, 10 major reasons why one might study
and
grammar.
Right.
The final one, though, does fit perfectly with what Nagarajanav Garo said, which it's in order to become like God himself, like Lord Shiva himself.
So, I mean, this theoretical openness, I think we should remember and think about the fact that it's coupled with, in terms of his category, at least of Ankara, is a very categorical conservatism. He doesn't want to add, he has a certain list of figures that he received. Bamaha is attacking this list of figures in several ways. And consistently, without exception, it seems, Dandan is defending a pre-received list of Ankaras. Now, if you have a system of categories or system of Ankaras and you confront newness, there are two ways to deal with it. You can keep the early figures in the boxes that they're already in and make up new boxes to deal with the new data.
Right.
Or you can expand. That's to say, so a model which keeps the basic pigeonholes of Ankaras but develops them, expands them, complexifies them as needed to both, you know, enrich and leave room for future enrichment, maybe in terms of productivity, again, produces rather than a sort of analyst perspective, maybe a more productive model. But it's not, it is both richly generative and open and conservative. And I think that's important to keep in mind. Thinking about Bauman and Dundon, especially.
Conservative, because another thing you can do with the things in the boxes is to throw them away.
Well, does he do that?
No, he doesn't do that. That's what I'm saying.
No. My point was that if you have well-defined boxes and you find new stuff and they don't fit, you can just make new boxes.
Yeah.
Instead of trying to expand or retrofit or complexify or develop the boxes you already have.
You mean conservative in a good way, Gary, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Conservationist.
What I mean is there were things that Bamaha wanted to leave on the curb. And Dandan brought them back in the house.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But just as a kind of an aside, note that while I agree very much with the model of creating newness by playing and rearranging and modularly and metatropically playing with the basic unit. Dandin says several times that there are more alankaras than the ones that he is presenting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In the beginning he says that they said the alankaras that he's presenting are only the bija, but then he says that what he has discussed in the chapter on margas are also alankaras. In the very end he says that everything that comes from the theory of Natya Shastra can also be considered alankara. So like everything that Dandin does, he leaves the door open for more, even in this way of just the box is not closed for new categories. And that's something that the commentators are keen on explaining.
And I guess, and that's as close as we actually come to a direct statement of openness as a method, right? I mean, some might see that as a kind of scholastic failure, but he really, you know, incorporates it explicitly.
Jenny.
A quick follow-up comment on that. I think there maybe, and really, I'll be very cautious about my statement about that, but generally speaking, in the Shastric tradition, there is an implied openness through the fact that you can combine features to endlessly produce categories. But the question of identifying the main axes and paradigms, how open is he about that? It's a question. I mean, in defining what are the main axes through which you will define subcategories, which will then allow maybe through cross-fertilization to this endless production of categories. These are two different questions.
That's very well said, that's true. Janet.
Okay, so this is speaking from the perspective of Dandin's success in language groups and areas that are totally outside of the Indo-Aryan languages. I mean, one question is, why Dandin as opposed to some other Sanskrit theorist of poetry? And maybe something about Dandin's work was especially well formulated. But another question entirely is, that are usefully looked at from the example, Chinese, Tibetan, Old Javanese, and so on, and South Indian languages have to do with larger questions that I think that to me are really interesting. One of them just having to do with the basic relationship between system, having a bunch of categories that you put in place that becomes an overlay on the poetic impulse more generally, how that works. One very big factor, certainly for the Tibetan case, has simply to do with prestige. So a certain desire to use this system because a certain prestige has been assigned to it, and that's a kind of easy way to look at some of what was happening. But the more sort of complicated cases, especially like say in the case of China, for me at least, is such a major example where you have a huge older tradition of poetic expression in a language that, arguably, the whole sort of understanding of the relationship between words and their meaning, the whole system of denotation and semiotics can be entirely different. And this is where, for me, the most productive lines of thought are. To what degree does a foreign system, work productively to get people to write poetry better? And to what degree was it a failure? To what degree are Dandin's aspirations really to say something universal about language? And to what degree do you have, this whole idea of, there's five alankaras or ten, the whole very notion of alankara, of there being, there is a body and then you put these ornaments on it, you could imagine an argument where that is not actually a relevant way even to think of how language works. And so I'm really talking and opening out into this big area, which I don't know enough about what to say, but I think it's just very important to keep thinking about Dandin's, the places where Dandin stops, and saw it very much this morning in the presentations and in the Chinese example. Tibet is a very, very strange case where it's worked very, very well, although you do have, again, a language that is completely, you know, anomalous with respect to Indo-European languages, so maybe that's enough.
Shinkai.
One thing, yeah, I guess looking at the thing that draws my attention are three cases, Kukai, Sakya Pandita, which we have we haven't talked about in this conference, but then also Anne's discussion of Soria. And what I see here is for especially cultures outside of this Indic circle is something about distinction between Yigal's term writerly and readerly model. So then what I see is in the beginning when those other cultures wants to import, to use that term, the standard model, I see this as the writerly model. So if you look at Gukai, you know, regardless of how much influence of Danden there is, at least it's clear it's, you know, going to a Japanese scholar, going to China to learn Chinese poetics, that's for sure. So, and you can see from this book that there's this strong emphasis on how to write poetry. And then going to Sakya Pandita's case, the Danden, he's the first person, and the Danden section is it placed within the section of the book which is about how to write. Right? It's about how to write. And then also Ammonius, the Virasoriam also, it seems like there are these, poetics is one thing, but then also there is grammar. And you can see grammar also in Sakya Pandita. So there is this idea, if you read Sakya Pandita, well, everything about India, we want to learn this, so put a little bit here and there. The more you can learn it is better, so it's not complete. Just put something here that this is a model that we want to follow. And then in Tibet itself, it's sort of beginning with this writerly model, but then once Danden is there, then the later commentaries can use what Danden provides as an aesthetic model to use, to read poetry. So say, to write a commentary on Madhura Chaita, and we can use Alangara as a way of reading poetry. So this is kind of a readerly model of Danden.
Andrew,
Luca.
Okay.
Oh, I guess this is trying to bring together what Janet was saying, and also this idea of openness in a certain way, and maybe actually are organizing metaphors for how we talk about Danden. We talk about Danden as if he does something, but actually Danden doesn't do anything. Danden is not present in certain places. Danden does not go somewhere and say something and then people agree. Rather, people use Danden's work. People, just like Sanskrit does not do anything, people use Sanskrit to do certain things. So I'm wondering, and so perhaps when we talk about other languages, and I think what we've seen in really interesting ways is the way in which Sanskrit is used, or Sanskrit tradition is used, or Danden is used to present specific models, or to present new ways about thinking, new ways of thinking. So I don't know, maybe this is my own kind of historian's hat going on. How do we actually do a history which preserves a sort of agency outside of a diffusionist model that Danden goes somewhere, even though we know he does not? Rather, people use Dundon's ideas in specific ways. So.
Andrew.
I've been trying to think of what it is about Dundon's Kavyadasha that does generate this hope and sense of possibility, and I think part of that is a sense of belonging to a kind of community, and I mean, this is what Charlie called a textual community. It clearly gives rise to very specific textual communities in all kinds of places in a way that the Kavya does not. And I had two thoughts in connection with it. One is the distinction between poets and professors. And you can get the sense from the Kavya Alankara that Pamaha is a professor. And I have very little to add to what Nagaraja was saying. But there is a kind of closing down of possibilities there. It's a kind of critical endeavor, which is taken up and by later Alankarikas who continue and expand the critical endeavor. But Dundin is a poet, actually, and has some kind of sensibility for the sources of poetic inspiration and kind of tells you how you get to be in a position where you can read poetry. This is part of the game. But all readers of poetry are, in theory, writers of poetry. And you can participate in something like this. And I thought that the second point is we are here in our Goshti. I thought that the verse that Thibault talked about yesterday is very important because this is one of the crucial differences. For Dundin, you know, not only does Dundin actually enshrine the Goshti as a kind of specific site where poetry happens, but his readers seem to recognize this, and one of my first kind of serious encounters with the Kaviyodasha was reading the Ratnashri Tika, and at a certain point in the first Paricheda, Ratnashri just kind of goes off on a kind of eulogy of Goshtis,
right.
And it's clear that this kind of very social way of experiencing poetry was one of the ways in which he came to read the Kaviyodasha, and many, many other people. So I'm not sure if that answers the why Dundin as opposed to Bamaha question, but I think it does have something to do with the kind of theorization, not just of Kavya as a set of principles and words and figures, but something that people in historical communities actually do.
Victor,
I want to go back to the very foundation of Kaviyodasha, and that is Kavi, the poetry, because it's very interesting to me how this notion went to Indonesia and how it went to China. And the ways it went to these two places is very revealing of how culture was transmitted to these places, Indian culture. So when the idea of Kavya goes to Indonesia, it becomes Kakawin. And it's an Austronesian language that it's being embedded in, which is very different from Sanskritic, Indo-European language. But somehow they say, well, we're going to make this Indic thing Austronesian. And there's still an identification between Kavya and Kakawin. But in China, you know, we were talking about the Bunkyo Hifurun so much, the Wenjing Hifurun. It's interesting that that word wen, you know, which I was translated as literary mirror, embraces the whole of literature, and that includes prose and all other types of literature. But in India, it's like the pinnacle is the poetry. So there is this, the difficulty of bringing Indic ideas into Chinese, and I liked another thing that Tom said that really I liked a lot. He talked about, and I'll call it the paradigm of covering up the footprints. So when Dundin or when Alankara poetic figures went to Indonesia, they did sweep a gentle layer of sand over the surface, but you could still see that there's this Indic basis. But when these things came to China, you got a huge Himalayan layer of stuff put over the top of it, so it's really hard to see it. And now the idea of Alankara in China is very well known in Buddhism, but it's the Alankara of the figure, the body, the human body, or a statue. And these are greatly elaborated, and Chinese Buddhists were fully aware of Alankara as a embellishment, adornment, but physical and visual. the idea, they knew that you could do this with poetry, but they couldn't work it out. They couldn't elaborate it so well because of the huge difference between this, as Janet says, this already formed poetic tradition, with very strong poetic tradition. It's very hard to push these new figures from the Indic language on top. But then the last thing I wanted to say in this connection is, even though there was a covering up of footprints in Indonesia, Charlie has some evidence that there's archaeological evidence of connections. So I'm kind of segueing over into Charlie.
Do you want to take that up?
It was just something that Victor heard me say to Tom, that Tom already knew about, that there's a branch monastery in Java from one of the Sri Lankan monasteries, Abhayagiri. And the last Buddhist community in India, South India, that we know about at Nagapattinam, the archaeological evidence indicates that it was an expatriate community from Indonesia. What's interesting is that it was serving Indonesian expatriates, but that the bronzes that have made us remember Nagapattinam were made by Indian artists, so that we see, you know, some kind of interaction in that. Just to point out, and just in terms of, you know, that once again, like the footprint of Buddhism and Sri Lanka shows up in the discussion of just connections between things.
I just want to follow up on that, because that inscription that mentions the Abhayagiri Vihara in Java, in the last line, it's very fragmentary, but it also mentions that these bhikshus are learned in Manu. And one of the things that is very curious to me are the parallels here with Shastric discourse. And you have this line in Narada, and Helen mentioned the Vyavaharapadas. There's a line in Narada that says, you know, there are these 18 mulas, but then the branches of law are themselves infinite, right? And it's very similar to, I think, Dundon's treatment of the Alankaras, which you also find in Sudor Alankara. And I wonder, like, how common are these sort of explicit invitations to expansion in Shastric discourse, and whether this is, I mean, related to perhaps a particular moment, or... I mean, because I'm not very familiar with that tradition in Sanskrit, so I'm sort of wondering whether this is explicit in many other locations.
I just want to say before I move on that the expansion or proliferation of categories, it can happen in various possible modes. There is a kind of cataloging instinct. It can go on forever. That's, I don't think, an adequate characterization of what happens in the Kavya Raksha. It's not just a technical, expansion. Like we see in other Alankara works, we talked about this in the modern Alankara, you know, there are these new, and there, you know, there's some other quality that applies in the case of the Kavya Darsha or its related, transforms or other bodies. And that's the quality that still needs to be defined, I think. Because, you know, it's true to say that there's an openness here, and I think it's not hard for us to agree on that. But we haven't defined what that openness actually means, what the dynamic of a more open-ended kind of, you know, categorization, let's call it, what that dynamic might actually be. One element of it, for sure, has to do with temporality, with the notion of the past is in relation to the present, and the present in relation to the future, and because that's built into the notion of category itself in a highly dynamic system like that. I was going to ask you, just so I'll let you talk, I'm going to ask people here to think about, if we go back to the text for a moment, about the logic of organization within the Kavya Darsha, which moves from Swabhavokti, in the Alankara, in the Artalanga, moves from Swabhavokti to Bhavika. So Bhavika, we've talked about it in the group, Bhavika is about time. It's pregnant with the notion of time. That's the standard
Way of talking about
it. Not in Dundon, true, but in but maybe implicitly in Dundon, right? In some sense. So
I think we should also address those kinds of questions. In fact, it would be possible to ask ourselves not only why he moves from Svabhavokti to Bhavika, but whether there are key figures along the way that actually infuse all the other figures. We've talked about this in the group, you know. But this is thing, Gil wanted to say.
One way I'm thinking about this is a resistance. There is some some sense of this, the way of thinking between a system and openness is a therapeutic resistance. On one hand, this laying out of an organization, but on the other hand, recognizing that the chaos is still there, not to kind of close down the order that it's been inhibited or thrown on reality, and in the danger of maybe, you know, over-centralizing other trends, but maybe it's resisting a literary turn of the rasa, right? The turn to the reader. Maybe there is an attempt to say, wait a minute, we are still in the art of the text, of the material. Okay, and I'm inviting your
anachronistic response.
I know. Yeah. I'll give a different example. There is a rumor about a first year grammar for Sanskrit. Right, that's called tentatively Sanskrit Made Easy.
That's a rumor.
Right, by three anonymous writers. And that easy, right, with a quotation mark, that's part of the title. I was fortunate to learn first year with an earlier permutation of that book. And I always say that the greatest thing about it is that it doesn't provide, it doesn't deliver you Sanskrit grammar, it prevents you Sanskrit grammar. It reveals the art of teaching Sanskrit is the art of preventing the student from being exposed too quickly to this terrible level of detail and difficulty by giving him, you know, opening these areas just slowly and very in a very comfortable, sane way. So that tension between the chaos and the order, I think.
You know, we had a student who studied Sanskrit with us. I don't want to name her. She found the endlessly proliferating morphology to be a kind of agony, and it reached the point that every time there was like a new verbal form, like the imperfect or the future or the aorist, she would burst into tears.
Yeah.
she managed so far. Now there's the aorist,
right? Samskritasya kashchana swabhavaha asti, saha rakhaniya. Yedi पर्वतः आरोहणीयः कष्टेन आरोहणं कर्तव्यं विमानेन तत्र गत्वा उपरि उपविश्य शैलः आरूढः इति न कथनीयं तस्य फलं तन्न भवति अतः संस्कृतं तथैव अध्येयं यथा तस्य हृदयं ज्ञायेत अतः दण्डी वदति स्वभावोक्त्या भाविकं प्रति भावात् भावं गच्छावः ये आरम्भः भावे भवति अन्तश्च भावे भवति भावं विना काव्यं नास्ति
there was something of Dundon in David's answer when we were working on that book and every time I complained to David, why do you give them an assignment in chapter 5 when the information on how to do it is in chapter 7,
yeah.
He would say, you have to show them that you trust them to grow beyond themselves.
Right.
Now that's openness.
Okay. David.
I think in the last few comments about the one author or the one tradition I think of that is an interesting parallel just in terms of the ability to hold two things in tension that kind of then produces a certain effect. I think of Panini. You know, I mean, of course, we have this idea of Anantaparam Shabda Shastram, you know, that Kavi Mimamsa tells us about grammar is like this. And that, but you, so the idea of maintaining the system, as you say, but then creating a technology of language to allow for, I mean, even these statements that he makes, you know, that there's many, many more things that we can do. This idea of this, you know, Bahula, Manjatarasyam, you know, Vikalpaha, this technology of attempting to install the optionality, the sense of possibility, and how language actually works, how poetry actually works, but still maintaining the system, the holding those two things in tension, reminds me a lot of what this Alankara Shastra and Panini, and this is when Panini can, you know, was importable, was exportable. I mean, the grammar and the study of the language, and maybe there's something about that, that the very impulse is to kind of has this in mind, this Anantaparam Shabda Shastra.
The Akriti Gana.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Akriti Gana.
Akriti Gana.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. So I think that's a productive principle, a productive methodological principle. One might think of what you could call the sort of fundamental generative tensions that are built into the Kafya Dasha. For example, just to mention one or two, there's the fascinating notion of whether Alankara is intrinsic or extrinsic to what is being Alankarya. And that's a tension which is never fully resolved. And you might, in fact, if you wanted, you could trace the whole history of the Alankara Shastra in relation to that problem. It's an amazing problem, and it exists, of course, in Dandin as a fundamental problem. Or you could also think in terms of, let's call it charm, manoharatva, important term. He brings it in relation to hetu, manoharatva. So then, you know, poetry, here's a poetic grammar in which charm is a highly positive and indeed necessary quality. So put that notion of charm in connection to what Gary was calling fancy poetry. Mm. You know, there is a tension there. There is a certain interesting and lively tension. And we might see, this is the thought, you know, you might see that tension working itself out very amazing ways in, let's say, a literary culture which is informed by other what we want to call them, incorrigible assumptions about what words and meanings are, you know, as Janet was saying. You know, that tension will take a different form in a culture which is perhaps not something that we identify from Kanchipuram in the year 700. You know. And we would find others, if we start looking, we would find other such concepts, you know, where of a tension which is ambiguously stated, or maybe stated repeatedly in ways that are not entirely coherent. You know, it's not hard to begin to think of possible concepts and terms in which that would apply. In which, in other words, you're not going to resolve some statement by a very hard and fast definition, but you're going to, like, set out a sort of hypothesis which will then ramify over time and in other cultures. Sarah, please.
Yeah, and, you know, I think English doesn't have a way of describing this, but one of the things that's so striking about all of the material that have been presented is that there's a logic of, or a kind of cultural value of imitation or being profoundly derivative in a non-negative way, which is why I think English doesn't have the capacity to describe it. But that, you know, something like imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. But beyond that, it's not flattery, that the imitation here is doing some really important cultural, aesthetic, linguistic work. And so we have this sort of way that imitation gives way to imitation. Again, I think that is the wrong word. But in the same process, in the same sort of, you know, kind of generative way, difference is somehow unfolded into that, such that the imitation is never the same.
Is emulation the word you were looking for?
Emulation may be the better word, right? So, you know, like, I came to this conference not expecting or not knowing what all of these other regional articulations would be, and they don't look anything like the kind of material, right? And the Javanese material doesn't look anything like the Tamil material. And so I think one of the big tensions here is how do we get at this process in which there's something the same, there's some emulation, there's something that connects all of these materials, but at the same time, they're all incredibly different. And so there's this kind of very deep tension, I think, that permeates all of the materials.
Yeah. I have to say something about innovation and openness and conservatism. There's something, I think another way in which Dandin is innovating that we've been missing, precisely where we're looking at what seems to be conservatism. And that is a key thing, which Dandin takes old categories, empties them of everything that was in them, and fills them with new stuff. That's repackaging.
You give me an example.
Yeah, I'll give you a few little examples. So the biggest, most looming example in my mind is that of hetu that David just mentioned.
Hetu,
causality, causation, yeah. Hetu, cause.
Not by chance, this is a critical example.
So you can see, if you read closely from Bamaha, that what hetu really meant for somebody like Bamaha is pretty much saying something in the ablative. that is to say, if something like a simile is a hetupama, it's the things are two things are alike because ablative of some similarity. That's okay. I'm not believing that. But that's a.
And he says it's bad.
But what Dandin does, and that's just. I recommend that you all go over and look at that section, one of the most beautiful, beautiful sections of the Kaya Dasha. He shows you that you can go to some Shastric notebook where you can find all kinds of reasons of causality, the Nayayika kind of notions of causality from the absence and from presence that leads to absence, that leads to presence, all these kinds of things. There's nothing like that. It's all Dandin. And what he shows you is all of these things can become alankaras if they can use this final vocabulary of kavya that Andrew has been thinking about. And they are so beautifully and re-estranging and reusing the same ideas that Tom has been talking about that are key ideas to Dandin, that is the painful aspects of things present, like the seven realms. So you see, I mean, that's amazing. Other things that you can show that he's doing with old categories that he fills with new, that I can, I don't want to go
well, in
on
fact, now. That's what he did with Sabhavokti.
Yeah, Sabhavokti, yeah. Bhavika.
Yeah.
I think this is what he does with Ninda and Achikya Upama, Vyatireka, Viroda. There's small changes, big changes, repackaging.
Yeah.
So now he expects his readers to know that he does that because they know Bamaha well. And they know what he does with that, and by doing that, he also teaches them to do what we saw many of his readers to do, which is to repackage this system. So just that's a point I want to make.
Okay.
And the other point I want to make that agrees with what many people have said is this: follow the pedagogy. I think that's a key thing. I wish. I mean, we heard today in Helen's talk about a kavya school. In the court in Indonesia, in which there was this kind of what seemed to be like a beautiful graduation ceremony. you got your robes and you marched and some people had different robes depending on different things that they did. So now this book is a pedagogical book. It like Andrew said, it is also it encodes the goshti itself. It you can take this and throw it into some water and there's going to create an instant goshti somewhere. this is your I think something that I wish we will explore more in the future is follow how this repackaging leads to better, like in the text that Gil has presented and many other texts where you can see or with Luther was presenting, we can see how new pedagogy is created. Sometimes you see Dandin himself or the text itself. Sometimes you see it's repackaged. Sometimes you can't see Dandin anymore. Maybe he wasn't even there, but you can see. But you can see this repackaging. Yeah.
So regarding what you just said, it would be interesting to know that in the Saladigaram, we have a formulation, inna ne de, which is explained as meaning the hetu, which is expressed by the third case or the fifth case.
Yeah.
So somehow that shows that the view of the world of a Tolkapian is closer to the view of Bamaha, probably.
Before you said that, although it fits very well with what you just said, I'm becoming increasingly drawn to the idea that the absolutely key methodological move in this text is the fusing of lakshya and lakshya, of definition and example. That's the definitions. The definitions don't stand on their own, and they actually aren't meant to. It's the definition plus the udaharana, which means I think they have to be self-composed udaharanas. And I think that what Bamaha wants is for the definition to adequately characterize the figure, such that if the alankara is hetu, using the ampliative, then anytime you do that, it should be beautiful, because you're fitting the definition. Anything that fits definition X should be beautiful. So bhavokti, any bare statement of fact, if it's an alankara, should be beautiful, and he says it's not. Yeah. What Dundin is doing is, in, not in definitional terms expanding, but giving a definition plus an example, saying that yes, you say whatever you say for Svabhukti, the cranes are flying, but it can mean all these different things. He's almost, I don't want to be too teleological, he's almost inventing the theory of suggestion in the background.
He's doing exactly that. He's doing exactly that.
Well,
can I ask a question?
Oh yeah, I want to finish this. So I think that's key to the open-endedness, that these lakshanas are not supposed to work the way lakshanas are supposed to work, right? And that there's a sort of tension between lakshana and lakshya, such that the category is, you know, has some kind of definition to it, but it's fluid. It has a kind of fluidity where it's exactly what post, you know, Udbhata and post Udbhata esque alankarikas in Kashmir, but mostly, you know, everywhere in the Sanskrit land, don't want. They've been adopting a more traditionally Shastric Vyakaran. I resist the analogy with Panini and Patanjali, because Patanjali, who's really the one who does all the thinking of all this, is trying to provide a finite technology to really, literally, absolutely, precisely master an infinite stream of data. That's exactly what he talks about doing, you know, versus the Pratipada Pada. You know, you learn the rules, you learn it Sarga and Abhavada, and it gives you everything. It doesn't really, because you need Akriti Ganas and you need all these little escape hatches, though it doesn't work. But that's the ambition. So I don't think it's the same. I think there is something distinctive and maybe unique about what does. It's hard to think of parallels in other shastras of that model, at least in my kind of travel.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask her.
I just wanted to go back to Igal for a moment. And could you just say again, what is it about repackaging per se? Why repackaging? Why is that principle important per se?
Let me think about this while Gary is speaking.
Yeah.
Well, my question might be connected. I really like what Larry has just said, and I was also thinking about the role of suggestion in these supposed lakshanas. But what I wanted to ask about, I just want to be clear on how that is connected with what Igal just said, which is also very helpful, about following the pedagogy, because as I understand it, this kind of lively interplay between the lakshya and the lakshana, with the self-composed examples, with the fact that the examples bring out things that the definitions only imply, seems to me a kind of lively pedagogy in practice. And Igal, you're saying that this is opposed to your viewing Bamaha as a kind of independent scholar who has a kind of declamatory role, but not necessarily a pedagogical.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll try and combine these two questions. I mean, Bamaha tells us exactly what he does, and he takes credit for this in the most clearest possible terms. He says, I came up with my own mind, with the vidhi for alankriya, that is to say. I devised a rule as to how you create alankaras, just as, you know, a kind of a vidhi of how you deal with ritual substances, that kind of thing. And what Larry has said, I think, it tells us that Dundin moves, Dundin nods to that, by the way, in a very unmistakable thing, because Bama, as he takes credit, he says, I invented this. And Dundin says he nods to the people who invented the vidis. But then he moves away and he creates a model where you can be more fluid and more playful, and repackage things in the sense that what is repackaging? Repackaging means that the most important principle of aesthetic principle is that everything can be everything else. Everything can throw light. You can take something and turn it upside down, and in that you create a space. Just like you said several months ago in our conversations, that by this movement of repackaging, you open a space. And in that space, you reflect on what you just did, and on what the poem does, and on who you are as a reader. There's this space that opens. It's this aesthetic moment that, for me, this repackaging, and I'm not sure I explained that so well. But
can I just add to that, that what that means is that in one and the same stroke, he's respecting the system, and if you don't mind using the term, deconstructing the system at the same time. And he's pointing to the very deconstructibility of system at the same time that he's re-inscribing it. I'm using Derridean language, I don't mean to do that. But that, I think, is a very, very important point, that he's actually calling attention he's foregrounding the nature of system per se and the places where system needs to be always reinterpreted, if you see what I mean. And that, I think, gets to the very dynamic between system and creativity. And that's the very tensions that we were talking about. Yeah. It's a very, very fundamental thing.
Going back to these same terms of pedagogy and repackageability, I mean, there's something I wonder about this. This is both an empirical question and maybe a more conceptual question about, I mean, another way in which he repackages is that it's a difference with Bahamaha, because so many of his examples are recycled. And interestingly, so there's a whole other element of virtuosity that goes into this. I mean, other people do. I mean, much, much later, say, like Abhinavagupta in the Tantra Loka, he cites things at great length, but he cites them by rewriting them. Mm-hmm. He doesn't feel the need to give citation for things we were talking about yesterday morning. So with Dundin, I mean, you can actually definitely see this as the outcome of a kind of pedagogical practice where these things are being discussed between him and his students, him and his teachers, him and his contemporaries, his fellow poets. But then when he turns to produce the treatise, which is the, you know, joint summary or the summation of what he actually thinks about this, he puts it all through this kind of very suave, unushtub style. Like the example, like Pibban Madhu Yata Kamam from Samasokti, which is, I think, this verse from Shakuntala, this verse from the Maharashtra Prakrit. So I guess the empirical and thus conceptual question about this is Ratnashri and other commentators point out in certain cases, no one actually does the criticism on the Udaharanas, but they point out places where he's citing Bahamaha, or he's echoing other people's views, or where he's picking up the Mahabhashya or something like that. But I wonder, does that end at Sanskrit? And what does that actually say when we have this massive empirical case of the reception in other languages, where our users, and maybe in Gilshing is that, Kannada might be able to make case here, but when we look in something like Tibetan, for instance, where they're actually doing the end user product, are they actually, I mean, is there, I mean, and I'll put it boldly, I mean, so is it, you know, is there like a vasana of that process that's somehow integral to the text, and that's part of the attraction?
I shook my head as a yes. It was a strong yes that it became a no. So right. Yeah, definitely. Just to correct it.
That I wonder about. Does this leave vasana in its basic structure, that people can kind of see that and kind of vibe off it in some sense?
Yeah. I mean, I wanted to add also just one other factor, is the factor of Buddhism, which is a very, very important factor in the transmission of Dundin. And one of the things about Buddhism is that it saw, as it moved to other countries, one of the primary problematics that Buddhism was dealing with is the very, you know, task of translation. And especially in the case of China and Tibet, being able to translate, you know, this very foreign kind of way of talking into their own language. And you have a huge amount, I mean, you have it in non-Buddhist stuff in India as well, but in Buddhism there's a huge obsession with the nature of language, the nature of the nature of conventionality and how conventions work. So it's a very, I think that the real difference between Tibet and China, for example, two major examples, is that in Tibet you have primarily a tabula rasa. It's not that there's a strong oral tradition, you know, there's certainly, you know, a language, a very well-developed language, but in terms of theory and in terms of writing, and writing, by the way, is like a huge issue here, you know, but anyway, I think the real case in Tibet was that it's like there was nothing else, and so they glommed onto that. But I think intrinsic to every time Tibetans picked up, you know, the technology of the Kagyu Darsha, they're constantly aware of the fact that they're applying a somewhat foreign way of categorizing, you know, language to something else. So that's kind of what you were just saying, is that built into this process of translation is the fact that, so that.
Picture.
I want to suggest another way of looking at this that encompasses all these notions of openness, repackaging, and translation, which Janet just brought up. I have a very Indic set of concepts that will encompass all of these, and that is transformation, nirmana, riddhi. It's almost magical how you can change things. A change came up in some of the papers too. But I want to give an embodiment of this in the monkey that I talked about in Journey to the West, Sun Wukong. He could do 72 transformations. And this transformation is very powerful. So 72 just means it's limitless, actually. So I think this idea of as Indic ideas move from one place to another, some places the transformations must of necessity be much more dramatic and thorough. But I would just suggest this is a possibility for looking at what happens.
PB, please.
So, after listening to all these speeches and taking part in the seminar, I'm not a Sanskritist, so, but I got something, especially about this Kavya Darsha. My basic idea is somewhat symbolically stated, if I say that, it will be like, you know, his Ishta Devata is Saraswati. And you can see that Saraswati is a goddess who is very dispassionate in all the activities or whatever, but she is also passionate in the sense that she is in charge of poetry and learning. Mm. So I think what Dardin has done is something like this, you know, like phonetics is to grammar, so is Alankara to poetry. So he has brought Alankara to the forefront and gives a graduated course, something like that, without leaving any kind of expressions that are used in the language, excepting those that are generally condemned among the people. So he says that those who use the word properly, then they are, that is the best thing, like it is Gavanga, or the, what you call the heavenly cow, but otherwise it will be like just a cow, you know. So that gives a kind of criterion. And I think the main way is that it is a sort of a very gradually, it is like a student-oriented text. He doesn't overdo things, and I think that he's writing something on very passionate things on a very dispassionate way. Hmm. That is how I understand
this. So I want to be sure we leave some time to talk about the other WH word. maybe we'll give ourselves another 5-6 minutes along these lines. Does that make sense? I know Charlie wants to say something. I just want to say before we leave the notion of transformation, we want to do something with it. Obviously, there are all
kinds of possibilities here, but one really important kind that comes up again inductively, empirically in Dundin, again and again, is the notion of intensification. Intensification, and if we want a Sanskrit word for it, we have vijrimbhana, and in later Alankara Shastra, we have other terms for it like upachaya and so on. I mean, but that notion of seeing, of a perceptual act, which entails or is imbued with intensification of some sort, linguistic intensification, that seems to me very kind of basic and powerful and productive way to go. Charlie.
Actually, when I asked a question that's directed to Larry and Gary and Gal, but picking up what Whitney said, Larry, you know, said, I think rightly, that Dundin is inventing the theory of suggestion. We could also say we can see him inventing the theory of propriety, autotune. So then the question is, and you know, Gary and Yigal shook their heads, yes, the question is, are we watching Dundin inventing the theoretical possibility of singular poetry? And would you say yes or no?
Hey, you have to answer that question.
No. So, if you say I have to answer it, then there's an answer in that, in which we say, oh, it's not an adhisthana, it's not a vasana, it's not something that is in Dundin that's kind of determining this future, it's how people used it. And that is a very, very crucial thing for a collective project. That one way of reading, which we say, oh, we're looking at things that are intrinsic to the text, then the other is, there's changes in the reception that come from outside. And then kind of, so this is a crucial kind of thing that, you know, that's why I'm directing to you and, you know. So.
Well, let me respond to that. If what you're suggesting is that by inventing the theory of suggestion, which I didn't say Dundin did, and I'm not necessarily saying he did, but I said it's almost as if.
You were suggesting that.
But you know, what I think, no, I was not, okay.
Whenever you start to say something important, it turns into an impression.
What I feel unable to answer is whether this proto-suggestion or whatever it is was somehow key to it being picked up by the Sinhalese tradition. Obviously, I think the Sinhala poetry could have been invented without Dundin or anything from the Sanskrit world, but it couldn't have been invented as what it was, as what it is. And if that aspect of Dundin is what made it attractive, what made it something attractive, whereas, you know, Bama or other things didn't do that, I don't feel in a position to answer that.
Let me just give a gloss, because it's a subtle use of language that shifts something that's going on to, like, it's extrinsic to Dundin. So the way to rephrase it carefully, can we read Dundin in which we say, it's as if he's inventing, and then for me, the important phrase is, the theoretical possibility of, in which he is not waiting for someone in Singular to come along and say, oh, it's interesting that you could use me this way. He is anticipating that, just as he's anticipating, he's open to other kinds of things that we keep on saying. And so then it's a question, is he anticipating Kannada, Tibetan, Chinese, Javanese, Singular, Hindi, and on?
Short answer, no.
All right, this I think is a major theoretical, and so one of the things to say, why? That we could, when you can say, oh, it's as if he's inventing the theory of suggestion, it's as if, and I'm happy with that as if, because it's teaching us something about Dundin. And if we say, but this other thing, that's only use. That's something that is imposed on Dundin. That's a major thing for us to know.
I think Andrew provided us with the theoretical resources for answering no about this the first day. I mean, I think he really did work with a closed set.
Well, except that, as I talked about Andrew about this later, that apaparamsa as presented in the text of the Kavya Darsha is potentially an open-ended set. There's no clear indication of what are the, what is the avichedika What's the delivery?
But it was restricted
factor?
In terms of the genres it could practice. I mean, you could write an osara and a papamsha, but
no,
could you write
no,
a mahabhasha?
No,
what's
an adi.
No, the thing is that
that's the other stuff
unlike
osara, though, right? That's not a mahakavya or a nataka or a shastra.
That's not specified. It could be a prakaravachaka.
He's very careful to place an adi every time he mentions anything.
Well, basically, from Gandhi's point of view, poetry in Kannada can only happen if Kannada, you know, is put into the upper Brahmsha box. Mm. I mean, if we read the text.
These choices, I think, are very, very crucial and should be brought to the surface and thematized. You say, if we read the text and then we say one way the text is open, and then we have another way when it comes to like a history of the reception,
right,
in which the text somehow is being kept away from. And so it's just a question. You know, that it could be that the writer of Kavi Rajamarga or the Sivas Lakara understood Dandan in a way that Dandan should have understood himself. Mm-hmm.
That could be. My short answer was, anticipated by Whitney, which is that I would like to hear what Andrew has to say about it, because the question I had at the end of Andrew's talk and didn't have time to ask it was, how do you reconcile the things that you were talking about with the sort of openness that Igal had already talked about?
So here's what we're going to do. Andrew, you're going to respond to this, if you like. And after that, we're moving into the future.
But this is moving into the wither question.
It is moving into the future.
It is a wither question, I agree. That's true.
Well, I think that in Dandan's world, there was some significant sense in which kavya, which is the practice that he's basically concerned with, and kavya is not the same as writing text, it's not the same as writing literature, even when, I guess. That happened in a number of languages, but the fact that it happened in, and that was a closed set of languages, the fact that it was already happening across several different languages, and that the forms of literature, that you could use these alankaras in all these languages, there was a kind of transferability. In fact, I mean, this idea of transformation, this is the way that people talk about the relationship between Sanskrit and Prakrit. It's parinama.
Mm-hmm.
That allows for the possibility, the conceptual possibility of writing kavya in other languages. And what remained to be done after Dandan is figuring out practically how that would work and doing the kinds of things that Tom talked about this morning, and that all of the other adaptations and parinamas of the Kavya Dasha in fact did.
Can I just pick up on one thing, because the word parinama in terms of Buddhism is extremely important, and just thinking about it one second, what parinama is doing, as in a merit transference, is turning something to a different future. And in that, you know, it is creating, changing what it was in the beginning, because you're turning it towards this different future. And the phrases in Japan that are used, poison turns into medicine. And so what you have is that thinking about what's happening in parinama is that nothing changes in the text, and the text is being used in the way that it's meant to be used, but it's turned to a different future in which we see what was possible in it that we couldn't see without this other future.
Yeah. Okay, so now that we're deep into the future, I want Igal to say something about where we're going as a group.
Before that, let me say this two things. This is so much fun. This conversation is so much fun. I hate it to end, which is why I want to say one more thing about for the previous conversation about openness, which is Dandan does allow himself to get rid of categories that come from Bama, doshas.
yeah, but from
so
Bama.
So he's telling us alankaras, alankaras are good. You can add more alankaras, and you can do new things with the previous alankaras, so long as you play with them nicely. Doshas, you know, the future. There will be a book about Dandan, inshallah. That is something I feel certain about. OK? Okay, I can't tell what the future would be like, but this is something we hope very much will.
The book already exists.
And I know some things that the book will not be. Okay, so it will not be. It will not be another kind of multi-authored volume in which each person gets a chapter that kind of replicates a conference proceeding or that kind of thing. This is not the model we're aiming at, and we've discussed this in a group, in a smaller group, a couple of times. What I think we're thinking of in terms of structure is edited chapters, multi-authored chapters, in which people from our typically from the core group, but with some exceptions, will be in charge of editing a chapter into which many of you will be asked to contribute in a way that, with their name assigned to a section that they composed, and it will be more interesting. I mean, this kind of the material, not just across languages, but even within a given literary culture, is so rich and so complicated that it calls for thinking together in the way that we've been just exercising, and so. What we hope for is not to replicate the model of literary cultures in history in that sense, but to create something that's more engaging. Now we will go back to the drawing board after this mind-blowing conversation that went on for 5 days, and I think that what we will do is start thinking about not just the structure, and there are many open questions I'll address in a second, but also a kind of a set of questions, a set of themes that we want every chapter editor and every chapter contributor to think about. And you know, if there's a question that you say, well, this is something that's irrelevant, then that's also already thinking about it and addressing it. So I think we'll get back to you. Give us a few days to recover, but we'll get back to you with initial conversations, some of which I'm sure happened already here, about what do you think should be a structure of a chapter, say, on the long story of Dunedin and Tomal. I'm not suggesting that all the chapters should be by literary or cultures or regions, again, in the model of Shelley's literary cultures in history. There are moments when I think none of them should be, but then I keep resisting this resistance because there are stories that have to be told that have never been fully told, like the story of Dunedin in Tamil, or like the story, the full, the amazing story of Dunedin in Tibet, and so on. So I think these stories have to be told, and have to, the justice has to be done to them in a way that we've never seen. I don't think so. But at the same time, there are all kinds of cross-thematic issues, Buddhism, for example. I don't know. I don't want to list them because I don't want to preclude them or I don't want to implant them. I want you. This is open. Nothing has been decided. Okay, that's the main point. Nothing but the fact that I think that there will be. We want to plan for a book, one book, and that we want to. And that the editorial responsibilities will be delegated to the people who do the different chapters, and that there will be a circulation of ideas, or we can listen to the talks, we can put more papers, we can circulate a set of questions, we can continue this conversation, by various ways. There are various technologies today that allow this. I don't want to get into this. I don't understand it myself, but there are ways of doing this. And so, is that enough?
Yeah, I see what people feel about this.
Reflections from a ghostie. Just add water.
Cold one. Hot one.
Or Russa.
Or Russa.
Russum, yeah, Russum, that's hot. Yeah. Just add Russum.
This would be a good moment, though, for people who might have, ideas of their own about this and about what they want to write, what the book should look like. This is a good moment to hear from you. We'll have opportunity to correspond with you, and you can at any point, of course, write. And the website is there, so that you have access to the discussions within the smaller group and all of that. But here's a moment where we could, think creatively. Yeah.
Kind of a logistical comment about maybe, obviously, some kind of collective email circulation, but a platform of conversation or several conversations that can be ensuing and continuing. Just throwing this out.
Independent of my own contribution, whatever it was worth, the thing that I'm, but this re-excited my thinking about, and Gary knows about this from a few years ago, was I was very excited about Samasokti a few years ago and the history of that figure. And since seeing all the your and Jennifer's presentations about it in Tamil, about Ortoni, I'm newly re-excited about it. So, so the biography of individual figures, I don't know if people will see that as like something that would be...
I think eminently possible for a volume like this. And in fact, more than possible, there should be such parts of this volume in which we can trace, exactly as you said, the biography of a figure within whatever range you might choose.
We're planning Madison panel on a specific Alankara. So if you're free in October. So that's one avenue definitely to proceed.
Okay.
Yeah, Janet.
Two points that I would make. One is some sort of collective reflection and resolution on a mode of writing that's going to be legible to a broad audience. And so a real restraining or handling of the kind of technical details which sometimes overcome and are just really, and we don't know what the point is or the point is not made clear enough. So that there's just thinking about who the audience is for the book and trying to make it in a way that it makes a point as a book, not just the Indonesianists are just going to read the Indonesian chapter and that's it. So that's, I think, one thing that we really have to work hard at doing. And then just a second suggestion that if we do it both, geographically, but then through themes, it could well be the case that people write for different chapters. So you have like a few paragraphs you gave to one thing,
absolutely,
and then you give,
absolutely,
and you might have a bigger thing somewhere else so that people are kind of mushed all over.
That's the idea, yeah.
That's innovative. I think conceptual.
That's what we've been practicing, mushing people.
Yeah, please.
Now that this idea was mentioned, why not trying to organize the book in an encyclopedia? Using the encyclopedic approach, like we can have entries for, not like for instance one entry could be Dandin and Buddhism, but you can also have an entry for a specific author who was influenced by Dandin, or a specific book that was influenced by Dandin, or that is not encapsulated in this. You'll have a section on like geographical areas, section on religion, but just again, an open-ended approach, encyclopedic, according to the different things that we've been seeing. Then we can all throw ideas and organize it.
If I may, that can be fulfilled by a very, very elaborately worked index. And that's that will be crucial, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, it's very constrained.
Yeah.
You know, this book that Tony Grafton and Glenn Moss did about the classical tradition.
Yeah.
I mean, that where the articles are really dense. I mean, I don't think we produced something that would be that much of a monument. But
that is an interesting potential model for something like this. I think our essays will be more discursive. that would be the problem, maybe, with an encyclopedia entry. I can tell you that from like the two or three such entries I've written in my life, they're the hardest things I ever had to write, and also they had to be the most condensed. You know, whereas here we need a kind of space,
something more expansive, but yet constrained too. I keep in my mind, I keep thinking of two words: digested and assimilated, so that somehow we want to fuse all of these disparate ideas into a coherent body of thought. And I think the model that Egal has put forward is a good one. You know, I have a book series at Penn, and I'm also an editor of series at other presses too, and one thing that's anathema is a festschrift in a conference volume. Yeah. Presses do not like these, and they don't work. But I think this is a great idea to try to really come up with a volume that's tightly knit together, and it somehow brings together all of these different ideas in a very creative way. Mm-hmm. It won't work if it... But an encyclopedia is good and useful, but things aren't brought together in an encyclopedia. They're just bits and pieces. I think we have the potential in this group, so much brain power, so much knowledge, that you can really fuse these things together in a very impressive way.
To make sure that there are plenty of Udaharana verses in this book, you know, is the main point of the exercise. Yeah.
We'll have Yigal's translation by then that we can key it to.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that we have to talk about what to do with that. Yeah.
That is already earmarked to some other.
Yeah, yeah.
You can use it.
But pieces of it.
Sorry. Oh no, I'm just kind of thinking out loud. What I really liked about this was that a lot of times when you talk about how texts move or how people use different texts or, you know, this sort of thing, it tends to, the reason for it tends to be already given by the field that it's in. Why does Dungeon go into Tamil? It's because Tamil, there's something about Tamil. Or why does Tamil, or a different example, why does it go into Sri Lanka? Because of Buddhism. You know, the kind of fields tend to determine the sort of answers. And the thing I was thinking about is what sort of categories could be central that would allow different sorts of information to be put together. So I mean, I just kind of wrote a list, you know, of how this text moves. You have translations. You have translations that is taking some part but supplying other parts. You have quotation. You have commentary. You have influence, very explicit. And then you have some sort of less, what do you say? Less marked influence. So, and in that way, I mean, I was just thinking about that because then you could talk about something like, perhaps, Sinhala and Tibetan together without making them about being Buddhist, but rather about being certain sorts of translations. And Kannada and maybe even the commentarial tradition together because they're doing different. You know, then different sorts of boundaries can be crossed. And different sort of conversations might be able to come out of that.
Gary?
I think Whitney's right that the book should at least include biographies of particular figures, and this should be done, the history of a figure needs to be, I mean, if we want to be serious about exposing the influence of Dundan, both in his openness and in his secret inspiration. We also need to keep in mind what Larry said about the importance of keeping Lakshya and Lakshana in contact, but I would say we need to do that not only within Dundan, but also in looking at the interplay of Prayoga and of Shastra. In the history of these figures, to see can we really show that something, I mean, looking forward, we can look at things that happen in Sri Lanka or elsewhere and ask ourselves, do we have any real evidence that there are things that have happened because of Dundan that might not have happened simply because of Bamaha? We can look backwards to the practice of people who we've seen in the last couple days were very influential themselves, Bhatti. Mm-hmm. Bhatti and Kalidasa How well does Dunedin's approach work in explaining what Bhatti and what Kalidasa were doing compared to how we might go about that using Bhamaha or Udbhata? Mm. So I think it's very important to try to actually deal with the real history of these interplays.
There is some experimental potential in what you just said. It's kind of a playfulness of examining Dunedin with in other contexts that are definitely separated from Dunedin, and what can happen when we do that. Mm. That's a kind of invitation for our own open-endedness and our own creativity.
Yeah, because the book in itself will serve as documentation of the development of the new mirror school of literary theory. But whether that also leads to new schools of Hebrew and English poetry is something we still have to see.
Yeah, this remains to be seen. Who knows? PB.
This can be compared to English traditions, you know, like, you know. So what I was thinking was that, you know, at the opening of the two texts, which are actually from the Kavyadasa tradition, and that is Upodhanakara and Sivaslakara, opening verse has referred to other writers like Bhamaha. I think it is Bhamaha already said Vamana in our traditions. Bhamaha and Dandina mentioned together, but the author takes Dandina as the preference. And the other work, Ramasharman, is taken, but as I tried to show you by Shlesha, he refers to Dandin through the opening verse of Chaturmukha Mukhamboja. You know, he more or less substitutes words of Buddha's virtues, using the word Vani, which is common for both words, and also Saraswati. So the preference for Dandin is very evident in both these instances. Now, why was that? I think earlier also you mentioned this, and we could think of why it is. And also when I referred to Siddhartha Sangharava in the morning today, because Charlie wanted to know something. So some of the alankaras which you worded differently in Sivaslakara, like Ayalsita, I told you that about this, which is for Utpreksha, but Siddhartha Sangharava view is Upe, which is directly taking Utpreksha as Upe. So that shows that even the later times, this text had some influence even on the grammarians who wrote about grammar tech, but using alankara, etc. So that diffused in our tradition, I think we can work on that problem.
I think we're going to have to stop in time for the last lunch. And
the final count.
1 second. Yeah. And okay, right. Listen, first of all, I want to say something. This was a wonderful week for me. I unfortunately had to miss one whole day, but in absolutely fantastic experience. I wanted to say a personal thank you to all of you who came here. It was really, really amazing. I want to thank Yael again, who actually ran it. And aside from that, we will definitely be in touch with all of you. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Let's go and have lunch.